Back in May, in celebration of Asian Pacific American Heritage Month, Penguin Random House introduced four new books to its Penguin Classics imprint. These include The Hanging on Union Square by H.T. Sung, Nono Boy by John Okeda, America is the Heart by Carlos Bulsan, and East Goes West by Younghill Khan. These things are beautiful and represent something I didn't even realize that I wanted, but among the authors is Younghill Khan, who is a Korean-American, which is just jaw-dropping. Why have I never heard of Younghill Khan before? My introduction to Korean-American literature was with Chung Ray Lee and his debut novel, Native Speaker, but Younghill Khan would write his first book, The Grass Roof, back in 1931. Now, this was about a Korean in Korea. He'd follow that up in 1937 with East Goes West, about a young Korean arriving in America with $4 in his pocket and a suitcase full of Shakespeare. And I love this book. It totally deserves its place amongst the Penguin classics, and it reads like it's always been part of the canon in some alternate, parallel, more diverse universe, which just doesn't push dead white guys. I mean, the thing read so familiarly. If I was a better reader, I could point to the fact that it reminded me of Hermann Hesse or Dostoevsky, but that's just English lit bullshit. I have no idea, really. It feels very familiar, like it's always been part of the canon. It's filled with highfalutin, elevated language, filled with ideas and $10 words as we follow our semi-autobiographical protagonist, Chung Pa Han, as he observes life around him in America. And Kang is a product of the literary world of that time. He was a fellow professor of English literature at New York University with Thomas Wolfe, who first introduced him to famous Scribner editor Maxwell Perkins, who purchased his first book. Kang remembers getting an advance check for that book for $500, which at the time represented more than he made in a month as a teacher. And Kang regularly dined with Hemingway and Fitzgerald, and yet for some reason I have never heard of Younghill Khan before reading this book. East Goes West is clearly a product of its time, and it offers up a window into America in the 1930s. But what's surprising is how vibrant that window is. Most of the media I've consumed about New York in that time it's mostly white. You'd think it was only populated by white people. The people of color that we do encounter are the doormen, the drivers, the laundry takers, or the shady denizens of smelly immigrant enclaves. But the New York that Younghill Khan writes about is this diverse place filled with blacks, Chinese, Koreans, Italians, Russians, Malaysians. And these people offer other immigrants a chance to get their feet under them. They will offer up room and board on credit, or maybe a meal in exchange for a poem. Things aren't quite as generous when he steps out of the edges of society where the immigrants dwell. America is also a place where people can be taken advantage of. Promises of wealth and stature come at the expense of servitude. Chung Pa Han works at a Chinese restaurant where 8 of his fellow waiters have college degrees, 3 with PhDs. Later on, he comes across a black elevator operator working towards his law degree, and yet resigned to the fact that he will never rise higher than what he calls a yesa job. There's an incident later on where he's living with an American family, and he invites his Korean friend over with his Korean friend's white girlfriend, and suddenly the family is incensed, and they're worried that Chungpa perhaps has designs on their own daughter, who they would never allow to marry an Oriental, and they would hope that Chungpa would never think to rise above his station and try and marry an American girl. Now, the author Younghill Khan would eventually marry an American girl. And it goes to talk a little bit about the history of the author. He was born in 1903 in what is now known as North Korea. Now, while being the father of Korean American literature, he's also the prototypical overachieving Asian. Not happy with the level of education that he was getting, he did the equivalent of walking uphill both ways in the snow to school. But in his case, he would make a 300-kilometer trek to Seoul to get a better education. He did that alone and on foot. Not even happy with the level of education he was getting there, he wanted to learn more Western science, and he found that he could only do that in Japan, so he stowed away on a boat to go to Japan. He was 13 at the time. Now at 15, he would return to Korea and was jailed for participating in anti-Japanese demonstrations. By 18, he had basically come to America working as a missionary servant with $4 in his pocket. And I worry about my daughter traveling to Portugal by herself. Kang would go on to get his Bachelor of Science degree at Boston University, and then a Master's in English Literature, as you do, at Harvard. From there, he would become an editor in Encyclopedia Britannica. He would teach English literature at New York University. He translated many Korean works into English, and he wrote book reviews for the New York Times. So how is it that I have never heard of this guy? Well, maybe it's just as well. Can you imagine if he was better known? He'd be used as this exemplar for every Korean immigrant family having to contend with a whiny second-generation Korean-American son wanting to borrow the car and stay out late on a weeknight. Well, Younghill Kang, at your age, walked 300 kilometers to go to school, and you just want to go out and hang out with your rough boy friends. Fun fact, my mom called all my friends in high school rough boys. Anyway, East Coast West is a hugely important read, well worth checking out, and it marks the genesis of Korean-American literature. And it offers this rare insight into America of the 1930s, as well as little bits of Canada, and it has aspects that I recognize even today. And don't dismiss this as an eat-your-vegetables type of book. It is a great and compelling read filled with wonderful ideas, and I highly recommend it. It's well worth checking out. So get some more Korean in your literary diet. In the meantime, I've been on a tear as far as reading goes. I don't know what it's like in your part of the world, but here in Canada, it is absolutely sweltering. So I've been enjoying air-conditioned comfort and doing a ton of reading. A lot of books that I'm hoping to talk about in the near future. Well, that's it for me this week. I hope you all have a great week of reading, and we will talk to you soon. Bye.